So where to begin with such impressive films? I guess right here with Jimmy, who I just met at a screening of his film, which is very funny because you saw in the clips the extreme conditions that he was under. And when we were leaving the screening, people were, it was when we were having that cold spell in LA, and everyone's like, oh, it's so freezing in Los Angeles. he's looking at him like, you've gotta be kidding me. So yeah, Jimmy was the one who you saw in the trailer on the side of the rock. So logical question for you, what the hell were you thinking?
Well,
it's a serious question. Yeah.
I was, well, you know, I'm a climber, so obviously I actually enjoy being up there, even though it doesn't look very pleasant. But you know, climbing is a little bit kind of like documentary filmmaking. It's not always very pleasant. You still do it though.
Of course, in this case, you were both documentary filmmaker and climber. Yes. So that's I can't imagine that. First of all, the climbing I can't even imagine, but having to shoot and think about shooting, and then what comes first, the documentary filmmaking or the shooting? I mean, did you ever drop a camera?
Yeah. Well, I mean, certainly in that kind of situation, you're a climber first, and you have to manage those risks and make decisions around managing risks before you can really think about filming. And I mean, just a little context, it's not like I was just a documentary filmmaker and then I decided to shoot this mountain climb. I've been filming and shooting expeditions for a long time, but this was certainly experience to be able to shoot on this particular climb. And so there's a lot of, you know, do I manage the climbing stuff or do I film? And certainly you miss a lot of great moments because you're trying to, you know, deal with ropes and ice axes and things. But it's a big balancing. You know, you film when you can, and you know, there's some basic rules. For me, in this kind of filming scenario, where the climbing objective is really serious, and your partners are depending on you as a climbing partner first, when you're up there, they don't care if you make a film about it. You know, they want you to be pulling your weight as a climber.
Of course, they were doing some of the filming too.
Yes, Renan and I were sharing. But the kind of ethos behind it is that you don't shoot, you don't ever slow down the climbing. That's kind of like, in my, you know, my opinion, kind of like a failure. Like, we have to keep the objective as a priority, and then you film when you can, and you just don't drop the camera.
By the way, I was familiar with your still photography from National Geographic. I was already a fan of yours, so I was very excited to see this. And it's no wonder this film is so beautifully shot.
Well, thank you.
And of course, you had a co-director, Chai, on this film. And often in filmmaking, if there are co-directors, after the filming is over, they don't speak to each other. In this case, for those of you who don't know, they are married. They were married in 2013. Are you still married?
Yes.
Okay. So how does that work, the dynamic of being co-directors of a project like this?
It's a lot of yin and yang.
Yeah.
It's a dynamic relationship.
Yeah.
Thankfully, I was not on the mountain, so that was definitely his domain, climbing that mountain. But we make it's probably one of the reasons why our marriage works too. Like, we're pretty good working together, and it is because we come from very different points of view, and we have often very strong conflicting opinions, but we find our way to the middle. And I think the work benefits from it.
And you have a very extensive filmmaking. Actually, it's very interesting because tonight all the filmmakers on our panel are veteran filmmakers. You know, often we have a first-time filmmaker, but that's neither here nor there, I suppose, but it was sort of interesting to me that everybody has had quite a bit of experience in filmmaking, and you've done quite a few films before this. So when you came into this project, did you have a sense of what it might be and what themes you might want to cover? Because there are so many. This isn't just climbing. This is about so many, well, I'll let you explain, because it's very complex thematically.
Well, I mean, the story was what every documentary filmmaker wishes for. I mean, it had the drama and the ups and downs, and the characters were larger than life. But, you know, for me, I know nothing about climbing. I know a lot more now. You really actually couldn't pay me to go on a mountain. Like, I can't imagine. Like, people joke I'm afraid of heights. Not quite, but almost. But I was very moved by the story of friendship at the heart of this film, because, you know, I certainly, as a non-climber, thought it was always about getting to the top of the mountain. But for those of you who haven't seen Meru, there's basically this act of friendship at the heart, at the center of the film, which shows that it was more important for them to stay as a group, to try to make, return to Meru for a second time, than to actually complete the climb. Like, the friendship was more important than the summit. And that was our guiding force. And also, contextualizing the risks that they take and understanding them as full human beings with families and who are making very sophisticated decisions because they, you know, they believe in this friendship and also this sense of mentorship throughout.
What about the concern, just on the personal side for you, your husband, going up and doing something? I mean, you let him, what the hell were you thinking?
Well, I have to say, you know, I'm so happy you brought this up, because a lot of our most difficult conversations in our marriage have actually happened in the public forum during Q&As.
So, all right.
So it's great. I'm really happy it came up again. And at this point, I normally let him answer it.
And how do you...
Yeah, no, you can take it today.
No, we're a team, and we talk about a lot of stuff. You know, this is an active, very, this conversation is very much alive in our marriage currently.
Yeah. Okay. Moving on.
What are you trying to do?
Yeah, exactly. No, we'll have a session afterward, Matthew.
Good.
You go by Matt, right?
Either one.
No, that means Matthew. Matthew's the one that made the film about the Mexican drug cartel. What the hell were you thinking? No, I should give you a more serious question. But, you know, it is one of those films that when you watch it, you're thinking, and like Jimmy, you were filming yourself. You were shooting, you were involved with the editing. What we saw in the trailer, that was some pretty life-threatening in a very different way than Jimmy. I mean, both of you made films where your life was in danger. What were you thinking?
I think my girlfriend is here with me, and my family often ask me that same question. You know, I'm not a war reporter. I've never been in any situation like this before. So it's an absolutely terrifying film to make. My last film was on healthcare, which was a different type of
terror.
Different type of battle,
yeah.
Shall we say. You know, so the film led me, obviously, as we saw in the trailer, you know, to shootouts between the vigilantes and the cartel, you know, meth labs in the dark desert night, you know, places of torture, places I never could have ever dreamed of filming in. And I really ended up with a story that I couldn't have predicted. You know, I thought at first it was a story of good versus evil, of everyday citizens sort of rising up against this evil cartel. And then quickly that story changed, and these lines between good and evil became so blurry. And that's what made it even scarier, is that by the end of the film, I didn't even know who I was with. You know, I could be on an aperitivo, on a mission with these guys, and truly not know if I was with the cartel or the people fighting the cartel or something in between.
It shifted, the whole story shifted in the middle of while you were, so you were sort of just going with the flow. How do you know when your story is over then? Are you asking yourself that as you're filming?
Funders were asking the same question.
The funders.
You know, this story had a, without giving away the ending for those who haven't seen it, you know, it has a, had a very natural end, shall we say.
It seemed like you had been, you were filming for quite a while.
I was down there. I was basically, you know, living down there on and off for 9 months. I think we had 120 to 140 shoot days. It was a lot of being immersed in this world. And, you know, I actually barely speak Spanish. So, which I actually think was an advantage to some degree. You know, there's so many times when I was surrounded by people trying to take my camera away from me, threatening me, and I'd often just sit behind the lens and pretend like I didn't know what they were saying to me, which helps.
Which you, well, you didn't.
Yeah. You know, and then there's times, obviously, in very scary situations where I didn't know what they were saying, and I think if I knew, you know, every word during some of those shootouts, I would have been far more scared.
Did you have Spanish-speaking camera operators or fixers in country with you?
I had a fixer who translated, but for a lot of the verite, which is what most of the film is, I was often alone shooting, so I didn't really have anyone to tell me exactly what was happening. I had a basic sense. You know, I could get to the bathroom decently well and order food decently well, and I could understand the sort of 50% of what was being said, but a lot of the sort of subtext I didn't necessarily understand. But I think it was fun to be able to shoot based on emotion, not based on dialogue.
Okay, we'll come back. We'll talk about all these films a little more later, just to sort of get in a quick intro with everybody. Alex Gibney, a name you guys might know because he's one of the most prolific documentary filmmakers working today, made the film about Scientology. So I think it's a... I think it's appropriate for me to ask you, what the hell were you thinking?
Asif, I think we know what's coming, aren't we?
Now, this is a complex one. I mean, this is really... especially since, just kind of jumping in here, you were the narrator of the movie. It was your voice narrating. So it felt very, very personal to you. And I wondered, what was your connection to wanting to make this movie?
Well, I thought of it kind of as a nature film, but kind of like a human nature film. And what was interesting to me was how it became evident to me early on that I didn't really want to make an expose. I wanted to make a film about how it is that people enter the prison of belief. What were they getting out of this at the beginning, and then how did they get to a place where they suddenly were doing things that they couldn't have otherwise imagined themselves doing? So it was that psychological journey that I found interesting. And over time, in the editing room, we realized something odd. I mean, the way you get into Scientology is through a kind of therapy, though the Scientologists would never say therapy, using this device called an e-meter. And it's kind of a question and answer thing where somebody audits somebody else. And I realized it was a lot like interviewing. Not with a machine. I don't hook people up, though I do have one in my office, just in case. It's mostly for the employees to see if they're lying to me.
But wait, that is a joke, right? You don't have one of those e-meter things?
I do have one.
You do? Where do you buy me? Is it like Target?
eBay. Yeah, and we had a choice of a number of different kinds. We went with one that I thought was particularly cinematic. So, anyway, that's what I was interested in. And you know, a lot of people ask about danger when it comes to Scientologists, and they do have a reputation for going after people. But it, as opposed to, you know, falling off a towering rock face or being faced with guns in your face, it's psychological cruelty and intimidation. That's what... That's the danger lurking in the Church of Scientology. It's that psychological cruelty, the ability to hook people on a drug of therapy and then use this kind of truth-telling mechanism to use their secrets against them in very cruel ways. So, there you go. Just another day at the park.
Yeah. I'm going to come back to Meru before we come to you guys, because we have a clip. Do you want to set up the clip for us, or should we just jump in and show people the...
Well, actually, Liz, we were just discussing this a little bit earlier, is I'm unclear which clip we're showing. I know it's one of two.
So I guess it won't get set up.
So no setup. But I support both.
All right. Okay.
Jimmy chose one, I chose the other.
We'll find out after the clip.
Yes.
Who chose?
I'm joking.
Ladies and gentlemen, Meru.
She chose both.
She chose both. So, so you guys must have had quite a lot of footage, not just from that one expedition itself, but the storytelling leading up to it. I mean, did you have much to, did you bring back a lot to work? I mean, because you crafted a story that took, how long is the film?
The film is 90 minutes about, but this is the secret of Meru, was there was no footage.
What?
You're joking, right?
No, like, I didn't know the footage that you guys, that you shot up there.
No, but that's the whole thing of the conditions in which they were shooting was that the climbing came first. So when, in the edit, I mean, of the climbing itself, we may have had 8 hours.
Wow. Okay.
And most of it was of the approach.
That's very little. That's
small ratio. I mean, it's and because, and there were no handles. I mean,
Jimmy disagrees with you.
No, I agree. It's just that you have very limited resources.
Oh, sure.
You can't charge your batteries or shoot very long takes. A, because you're busy doing other things. So you had to be very selective with how you shot, when you shot. We carried 12 batteries total. Every ounce counts on a climb like this, so we like cut the tags off our jackets and everything. And so to save weight, and because of those limitations, you couldn't film that much.
That's incredible then. If you had such little footage, the storytelling that you did with such little footage, you would never know. You would never know that. And then, of course, you had the interviews to fill it in, which were very well done.
We thought of sending them back for a reshoot.
Yeah.
Speaking of footage or lack of footage, Asif. Let's talk a little bit. Asif made the Amy Winehouse documentary. So you set out to make a documentary about somebody who is no longer alive and who you cannot interview. And so I would imagine, and I was just wrong, so perhaps I'm wrong again, but that one of the first things you would set out to do is to try to find existing footage. Or talk to a little bit about the footage that you did put the film together with.
So with Amy, it kind of came about an interesting way because initially, I didn't know the story. So one issue is you know about this person, but I don't know what the story is, so I don't know what I'm trying to show.
So what was the draw?
Questions in my mind that something just didn't feel right about her story or her life, or I didn't really understand why it panned out the way it did. So it was almost like an investigation to try and understand her. Now, I kind of grew up in North London. I lived very close to where she used to live. I was in that area around Camden for about 10 years. So her story was kind of going on down the road. And initially, I just started talking to people. I previously made a film, Senna, and this film is kind of a continuation of that sort of style of making a film out of archive about a person I've never met. So it's like the whole thing is like you're delving into a world. I didn't know much about Formula One. I wasn't a huge Amy Winehouse fan. I never met her. I never saw her live. But there was enough there that kind of intrigued me. And so on Senna, what's interesting is that everyone loved this guy. Everyone wanted to help. Everyone wanted to talk. With Amy, it was almost the opposite. Nobody wanted to talk. Nobody wanted to be a part of it. Nobody wanted to come near me. Partly because there was very little trust in kind of journalism or newspapers, or was I another paparazzi person? Was I going to just kind of steal something and sell it to the newspaper. So initially, a long chunk of the process of research was just getting people to trust me enough to meet. Just talk to me. Give me 5 minutes. Just meet with me. And tell me why you're so angry. Tell me what you're so upset about. Tell me what is this big secret that you're all talking about? Has something awful happened? Some story went on with Amy, but you don't want to talk about it, and you don't trust anyone. So it was just a process of building up trust. And in the end, the way it kind of worked would be, we couldn't meet in a cafe because everyone kind of has ears, and there was a real kind of paranoia, actually. So we met in a very, what felt like a safe place. It was a sound recording studio where it'd be just the two of us in the room. There was a microphone on the table. And I said, I want to just talk to you. We just want to have a chat. If you don't feel comfortable or you don't want to talk about something, don't talk about it. But if you do, even then, I cannot use it unless you agree for me to use it by signing a release. That's the deal, okay? And nothing you say will go any further unless you agree for me to use it. And it became kind of a series of interviews that became like therapy. So initially, they'd come in for 5 or 10 minutes, and they'd be there an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours later, crying, you know, it'd be, everything suddenly would come out.
They wanted to talk.
They were
all
pretty raw. They'd never spoken to anyone really about it.
It seems like they really wanted to talk.
They had to talk. They were not well, actually. Everyone was becoming quite ill. And one person would then talk and say, well, you should talk to my friend, and you should talk to so-and-so. And eventually, I spoke to over 100 people, most of which just audio interviews. It was only once they trusted me did they say, well, actually, I do have these photographs. I do have this home video, or I've got an answer phone message, or... And then the little pieces of visuals came along, secondary.
Alex, I would imagine for your film it would be a similar thing in terms of getting, convincing people, or not convincing, but getting the trust with the interview subjects to be able to talk to you.
Yeah. It was hard, and not for everybody. There were a number of people who were eager to talk, but some people were scared of the blowback they might receive from the Church of Scientology. And so it was the same kind of process, sitting down, talking over coffee, coming back, talking again, building trust.
Were there changes in the way you went about setting up the interviews and the locations, or was there discretion you had to exercise?
Yeah, we had to, burner phones and making sure that we would set up locations to which interview subjects would come, unannounced, so that the gear would arrive at a very different place as the person and so forth and so on.
And Matt, it must have been similar for you as well. I mean, there were language barriers, but also getting people to trust you. I mean, it's amazing to me when I watch the footage that you have in Mexico, you have the police force, you have people that are, you're filming them right there, and they're consenting to, in doing the interviews, was it difficult to build trust there? Was it even possible?
Yeah, I mean, trust and access was sort of the basis for this film. I wouldn't have a film if it wasn't for that, and I think from the very beginning, with all my different characters that I spend time with, I sort of told them, I have no agenda, I have no goal in mind, I have no sort of preconceived notions of who I want you to be or where I want this story to go. I just want to experience your experience. I want to spend time with you. And I think that was something that they were all open to. They were all welcomed me with open arms for the most part. And so, there's certain characters, obviously, the film opens in a meth lab. That's something that I fought for and I fought for and I fought for.
Fought who?
To get access to. Not physically fighting. But.
No, but you're pushing who, convincing?
Trying to, every
how
shoot.
How do you go about
of...
finding a meth lab in Mexico, and who do you talk to?
Well, that's sort of what I wonder, too.
Because you look a little bit like someone that might be in a meth lab in Mexico.
Yeah.
No.
I first tried my meth dealer, and then that didn't work. No, I mean, seriously, like most of the meth that we consume here in the U.S., comes from Michoacan, the place that I filmed in. And so it was a very important part of the story. It was the lifeblood of the cartel. And so trip after trip, month after month, we try to find people who were connected. And we failed. And then it was on what I thought was our last shoot, about 9 months into filming. We got a call saying, be in this town square at 6 p.m. and you're in. And so we went to this town square, and a group of masked men met us. we'd arranged beforehand, if this situation would ever happen, that my rule is I didn't want to be bagged or thrown in a trunk, and their rule is that their faces would be covered. And so they led us through these towns and smaller towns and fields, and then they stopped. And then another car led us into this forest. I've actually never seen Breaking Bad, but I'd always sort of envisioned this like halogen-lit trailer-like setup. And I get out there, and the sun's dipping beneath the mountains, and I don't shoot with lights. I don't know how to shoot with lights. And so I was just hating myself. I couldn't believe I'd fought for so hard to get in this situation, and I couldn't see a damn thing with my camera. And so luckily, the head chef starts showing me around the lab with this little flashlight. It's with this little flashlight that I lit the scene.
Wow. So many thoughts, but... and Liz, I know we'll get to just what asses you were just talking about your interviews that you did, and they were audio only, and you know where I'm going with this, but we have a room full of a lot of directors and documentary directors and aspiring documentary directors. But what you did with Senna, and then with this film again, is unusual in many documentaries today, because you didn't show the people you interviewed. It was just their voices. That's a choice that came from where and how?
It's an interesting question, because my background is also making, writing and directing fiction films. And my early films had very little dialogue. I mean, the story was pretty much told entirely with pictures. My first feature was a film called The Warrior, and it had like 7 minutes of dialogue in a 90-minute film. So it's really about how do you tell the story in the cut? How do you tell the story of images? That's kind of my training, I suppose. So Senna was my first attempt to make a documentary, and it came out of footage. I started looking at the footage while I was doing my research, because I didn't know that much about him. And I just thought, this is the best set of dailies I've ever seen. You know, I thought it was just all here. There's an amazing middle, there's an amazing ending, I don't know where it begins. And I just wanted to plug holes with audio. And with Amy, that was kind of the instinct, was I'm going to try that again. I don't know if it's going to work. I don't know if there's a film. I don't know what a film is. But with Amy, I knew I had her songs and her lyrics. And the spine of the film would be Amy's voice as much as possible, but then her pages from a diary, which became her songs. And the question would be, which songs in which order and which performance? And then the idea was, how do we show what's going on in her life that leads up to each of these kind of musical moments where you break out? So that was always the instinct in it. I'm kind of, I don't know what it is, I'm kind of stubborn, but I feel like I kind of have a vision of how I want to direct the film. And then I want to follow it through. And it's not always the easiest way. I mean, Senna was like 5 years of editing, Amy was 3 years of editing, but that's kind of the process that I kind of madly go on. And for me, the aim, if possible, is to make it, because it's really hard when you see a clip. It doesn't look great technically, it's not great footage, it's quite crap actually, a lot of it, but somehow the idea is to kind of make you forget that it's all of these little pieces found everywhere, but somehow they should join together to give you a sort of overall cinematic experience. And Alex and I were just talking, for me, a lot of the time with drama, it's about kind of trying to create some sort of perfection, and actually it's the imperfections of the archive that I quite like. The glitches, the scratches, the shaky camera, it's all real, there's one take. There wasn't a second take. That was a moment when a certain thing happened, and that's the footage that tells the story, and it doesn't matter if it's imperfect. And it's kind of learning to trust that. But a lot of work goes into the sound, into the music, into the, you know, making it sound as good as possible makes it look better. That's the other part of the process. So I have a really great composer that I work with, Antonio Pinto, who, you know, did City of God or Central Station and works with Michael Mann. And then, so I kind of use the music or use other tricks of the trade of directing to try to tell the story. That's kind of the idea.
Yeah, well, it worked beautifully. Liz, I'm sorry we're out of time. I've known Liz for a long time.
This
is a good place to come to Miss Simone, because we're talking about archival footage and also a subject who is no longer alive, and so you can't go into this film and do an interview. So what is it about Simone, Nina Simone, that you personally connected with and made you want to jump into this commitment, long commitment.
It was everything about Nina Simone. I mean, to me, that she was, is a dream subject of a documentary. I mean, she was one of the most brilliant artists of the 20th century, and but yet never got her due, inspired so many artists who stand on her shoulders and give her those shout-outs, but suffered from essentially a blacklist. And also, you know, spoke, you know, was one of the brave, clear voices for civil rights, and her music is as relevant today as it was when she created it. So the film was everything. She was everything. But what's interesting is actually I was kind of able to get to Nina Simone. I mean, one of the first things I did when I started this project was try to find, you know, I tried to find every scrap of her that I could. And, you know, starting from the late 50s through, you know, she had an incredibly long career, you know, through, you know, she was performing until the year before she died in 2002. And in this incredible hunt, we were able to find hours and hours of audio tape of Nina talking and of Nina telling her life story. She had written a biography and she had a co-writer. So I thought, well, did he tape their conversations? You know, how was he going to help her write the biography? So we started to track him down. We found him on Facebook, and then we finally, months after we messaged him, he got back to us, and then he was in Australia, but maybe the tapes were in his home in the Pyrenees because they had written the book in France, and, you know, he won't be there for 6 weeks. Can we go? Well, no, you know, and then, so finally, on New Year's Day, it was like this 6-month exchange of emails. He said, you know, Happy New Year. I've got these tapes. So we got on the plane and, you know, went to this town in the Pyrenees and, you know, transferred all this audio material. And it was kind of, you know, it was extraordinary because, you know, she had sat there and told a story. The audio quality was, you know, they were in cafes, they were in, you know, trains, they were everywhere talking. But, you know, I was really able to get that interview with Nina Simone in that way. And then it wasn't just that interview, it was, you know, radio interviews she did in the 60s, in the 70s and 80s. So her voice was very present in our film, which was, you know, it was a thrilling kind of gift from you know, the grave in that way.
Well, that was just the interview side, because you have phenomenal.
And then, of course, there's all the concert footage and you know, I was blessed by a NYU student in 1968 who shot her in the Village Gate and, you know, in backstage and in her house in Mount Vernon and hung out with her. And he was an incredible shooter. And we got his work print and, you know, retransferred everything. And, you know, unfortunately, a lot of his stuff was in a storage facility that burned down. Isn't that always a story? Isn't that always something that happens? There's a storage facility that burned down. But in any case, so yeah, we had this, you know, we had incredible footage to work with. And then, you know, her letters and notes and diaries, some of which came from the family, some of which came from journalists that she had collaborated with. I made a film about Bobby Fischer, who was also a very complex human being, and he was so reclusive and never wanted to talk. One thing about Nina that was a gift was that she was raw and processing and shared her ideas fully. And so there was a lot of her for us.
Let's take a look at a clip.
Don't ask me to set it up. Don't ask
I'm
me
not
to
gonna
say,
ask
okay,
you to set
okay.
up. I'll set it up. It gives us an opportunity to see the archival footage in action, intercut masterfully, if I might say, together with the interview footage and also some reenactment, a little bit of reenactment footage.
Let's
so,
see, yeah.
A lot
Let's
of tools. Of,
so this is little on. Nina. This is.
You're going to set it up anyway.
Well, no, because now you said it, so I remember what it is. But you are doing a great job.
Oh, all right.
I think this is. Is this the one of her a concert that Nina did when she was 12?
Yeah, it starts with
So Nina was a classical music prodigy. When she was 6, she started playing the piano. She grew up in the Jim Crow South and was embraced by both black and white community. And there was a fund put together by the people in the town to give her music lessons. And Nina's big dream was to be the first black concert pianist to play in Carnegie Hall. That was her vision. She never sang. That wasn't part of who she was.
And so, what a pianist she was.
And she was an extraordinary pianist, but that dream ultimately was denied, and, you know, Eunice Wayman became Nina Simone. But I think this is a scene from an early concert of
Great.
Hers.
Let's look at a clip. What happened, Miss Simone? So, Liz, I have a crazy question.
Yeah?
And I'm not even really sure how to ask it, so I'm just going to muddle my way through, but I'm sitting there thinking this. As documentary filmmakers, we usually we connect very strongly with the people that we're interviewing and following. And writers of fiction often talk about connecting with their characters so strongly that the characters essentially write the script and say things that are unexpected. Asif, you could, you know, may have had that experience as well as a writer of fiction films. When you're delving this deeply into someone's life who's passed away and seeing every bit of archival footage and reading their diaries, you see where I'm going. Where, you know, did you feel a sort of connection? Did you feel her voice at all guiding you? Boy, I sound really kind of woo-woo, right?
No, but no, you, completely. Yeah, no, I mean, you feel it's a very... Yeah, I mean, you're entrusted with so much. I mean, being the recipient of those letters and diaries. I mean, there was, you know, there was... Nina was, you know, a person who was, you know, had highs and brilliance, and she also had real lows. And, you know, a lot of the writing, some of the writing was stuff that was, you know, not necessarily stuff that I felt like would be useful to share with the world or was more salacious in that way. She had, you know, there were moments that she was at her worst. So you're also kind of, you know, you're taking care of their legacy at the same time as you're making a truthful story.
Did you ever hear her voice saying, "Little Liz, don't"?
No. I mean, the truth is, I mean, Nina...
Not literally, but...
No, but she went there. I mean, you know, we were, you know, the tapes that we were listening to were things she was telling a co-writer. I mean, there were things... She was very, very... And she's one of the most, you know, brave and truthful people out there, I think. And I think that, but I did, yeah, I felt protective of her at the same time as I wanted to make a film that was honest and would really, you know, explore, you know, the craggier facets of her life, which, you know, she also was quite vocal about, and her family members, because that was part of her struggle and also part of her genius and also part of a larger society that created... the boxes that she found herself in.
What about your experience?
Well, it's so interesting that sometimes, you know, I would connect with her in the strangest ways. You know, she, going through her notes, I mean, she wrote copious notes, and when she was on the road, and she would write things about her daughter Lisa, and like, was her laundry done, and, you know, did the babysitter know about this lesson, and, you know, I'm a working mother who's on the road, and I'm obsessively not making notes, but texting, you know, I mean, the way, you know, it was so interesting to me to kind of identify with her actually as a working mother on the road. So, yeah, you find these points of connections that you wouldn't necessarily find. That was something that was... interesting. And then, of course, yeah, the emotional connection, you know, somebody suffering with bipolar disorder, it's certainly something that I've had firsthand experience with. So, I felt very deeply connected to her. And, like, you know, that her story was crucial and important, and she's a hero. And, I felt very honored to be on that journey.
I find it in some strange way, even as a viewer, connecting with her in ways I would never have expected.
Okay, so tell us. Was it the working mother on the
That's
road?
That's for no, it wasn't the working mother. It was just the extreme highs and lows and the desire to express herself as an artist, her anger at, you know, and so anyway, that's not about my
Well, and then also, I mean, and the last thing I'll say, because now I've kind of like made up for my loss of time before, which, you know, I intended to do, but no, I will also say that, you know, I think that there are moments of connection, I mean, being within a family with domestic violence and growing up and her being, you know, very much loving someone madly and deeply who was also the greatest antagonist in her life. And I think that's something that, you know, her story kind of people can connect with it in a lot of different ways.
Asif, did you have a similar experience with Amy Winehouse?
That's an interesting one because, I think what happens during the film, you get to know someone really well. It's like she's a friend of a friend now, I suppose is what I'd say, because she was a bit of a, she's kind of an ordinary girl. That's why I sort of connected to her. And I've spoken to so many people who were close to her that knew her. I've seen so much footage, good and bad, you know, all of the extremes, that you kind of do get to know this person. And then you're trying to find the essence of their life to fit into a film. Because I've seen thousands of hours of material. And it's just like, what goes in? What do you pick? For me, there's always a stage when you're editing, when, you know, you go to sleep and start dreaming about that person, and you know, you start thinking of really bad edits and you kind of, oh, that's a really bad cut. And that's just in a dream, you know. Or if the worst thing is when someone brings up, what are you doing during a dinner party? And you're like, don't want to talk. And they go, oh, God, what are you doing? What are you doing? And then my wife says, shut up, don't say it.
Wait,
then you bring up Amy Winehouse.
Why is that?
Because then you can't get off the conversation of Amy Winehouse for the rest of the night.
Because you're just obsessed.
Well, everyone wants to know, and everyone's asking about certain people, and then once it's off, yeah, it kind of takes over. Because you're a bit obsessed, I suppose. You've been in that universe so deeply. And the interesting thing about Amy is that, like, everyone I know is connected to her. You know, I didn't know her, but everyone I know, I've got friends who went out with her, you know. I live in an area still where, you know, on the way to the US, my cab driver's kids went to the same school as her, and they knew her. And so everyone is somehow one or two steps removed. So everyone's got a story. Everyone somehow met her. Everyone remembers a particular incident. And so it just sort of spreads out. It was very much, for me, starting out, it was a London film. You know, it was a film about where I'm from. And it's a film about now, how the world is now, in a way, in London. You know, this idea of what happens if you're into music and you become successful, and how you become part of the media, you become part of the kind of entertainment business, and then how they can also turn on you. You know, the same journalist that interviewed her or went after and hounded her were the people interviewing me when the press came out. You know, so it was a strange kind of dynamic to suddenly find yourself in that world. You know, when you make a film about Amy and what happened to her with paparazzi and journalists and things like that, and then the weird experience of the film was in Cannes, and then, you know, you have all these people taking your picture and doing press and talking to literally the same people who met her, who interviewed her, who dressed up as Amy on Halloween. And, you know, because they opened up about it, how guilty they felt about what happened, because they didn't think about making fun of her. They didn't think of her as being human for a long time. She was just someone who was asking for it, you know. So that kind of attitude became so present. Every comedian, even the nice ones that we all like, could make fun of her on TV and not worry about it. And so that became kind of an interesting part of the kind of dynamic of them meeting all of those people while doing press, and then thinking about, yeah, we didn't think. It was just what you did, you know.
Alex, your film is not about L. Ron Hubbard. He's the founder of Scientology. Not about him specifically. It's a much bigger story, but he's a fascinating character. And I wonder if you, in your journey, were able to, a bit what we were just talking about, get into the mind of this man.
Well, I think that, I mean, one of the things that Larry Wright wrote about in his book, and he was the guy on whose shoulders I stood when I was making the film, was, you know, at some point the religion of Scientology, and Scientology started out as Dianetics, which was kind of a self-help thing after the war, and Hubbard was a science fiction author. But the journey into Scientology is really a journey into the mind of L. Ron Hubbard. And that can be a scary place. So I tried to dip in and out.
Did you have much to go on? Wait, like,
well, there was a lot of detail about his life. I mean, there was a fictional account of his life that's been written, that was written by the Church of Scientology. One of the things that Larry did was to find out what had really happened. You know, he had made up a story about him being a World War II hero, for example, and it turned out that actually he was basically pulled from his commission because he shelled Mexico off the coast of the Pacific. But we were also able to find these memoirs of his second wife, who the Church of Scientology had expunged from his personal history, and discover she was there when he, you know, came up with the idea of using Scientology to make money, because he always felt that religion would be a great way to make money because they don't tax you.
So he was very open about that. That was his
early on
with his wife,
according to his wife, and he was also very brutal with her and kidnapped their child. And so he was, and yet at the same time, we talked to a number of people, one of whom was in the film, who remember him very fondly as being, you know, very charismatic and a great storyteller. I mean, he had to be a great storyteller. I think he has the Guinness Book of World Records for typing the most, and for him, typing was a physical activity where he would literally sweat as he typed. He was a great storyteller. What a combination, salesman, a science fiction author, dabbler in the occult. It was a, you know, he put them all together.
You found some, you have some great footage of him. So we'll take a look at a clip from the film. And also, for those who are, since we're talking about documentary directing, this is a clip which, within the clip, you pretty much have every convention, every tool of the trade portrayed within that clip, which is it's very interesting. A lot of documentary sources, archival footage, archival photos, archival interviews, new interviews, music, montage, lower thirds. Interestingly, though, in this particular clip, audio design, which is you don't really think that much about in the way it's used in this clip. Pay attention to when you're showing photographs of a wedding, or he's talking about getting married, and in the background we're hearing the church bells and the group, but we're not seeing. So that's just an aside, but this clip is very interesting to also see L. Ron Hubbard and really get a good look at the man. So let's watch a clip from Going Clear, Scientology and the Prison of Belief. Alex, the film alleges that the church makes a concerted effort to go after enemies of the church and make their lives miserable.
It's called fair game. It's a doctrine.
What about you? You touched on it earlier just a little bit, but I'm just curious to know what kind of repercussions have there been for you in making this film.
Mostly head games. Now, you can go on to, I should say, there's a Scientologist here tonight who's a filmmaker, who's done a number of films on the evils of psychiatry, and he's making a film about me right now, so that may come out next year. I don't know if you'd like to. You know, and you can go on freedommag.org and you can see short films that vilify everybody who's in the film, and me, I should add, going after my father and other things like that. So I think
going after your father?
Well, you know, it's... Yes. But...
what does that mean?
Well, in the portrait of me done by the Church of Scientology, you know, they allege some things about my dad. You know, par for the course.
And so, seriously, someone, there's a member of the Church of Scientology that is making a film about you.
Yes.
And who's here tonight?
He is.
Okay. So
you want to stand up? There he is.
We'll get to you with some questions after when we do a Q&A with the, right. Be the first one. Matthew.
Hopefully I don't have someone making a film on me.
Nobody is making a film on you. Do you know?
Matthew Land.
Nothing to aware of. But in terms of repercussions, I mean, you were not, it's not, a, you don't paint a very favorable picture of the government in Mexico. And, you know, a lot of allegations, a lot of, have there been any repercussions? What have you heard? What has been the response from the Mexican government, from others, if any?
I think the Mexican government hired a good PR firm because they have remained quiet since the film has come out. You know, for me, actually having the film released in Mexico was extremely important. We fought to make that happen, and it actually was released theatrically at the same time it was released here in the U.S. You know, I think one of the things that surprised me was actually how shocked people were there when I went down to the premiere about what they saw. You know, in Mexico, almost every day you open the paper, there's often headlines of about cartel violence. There's often dead bodies and in the paper almost every day. And I think I was very surprised at how surprised people were about what they saw in the film. This window into this world that had often been relegated to headlines and pictures. And that was really one of my goals in making this film, was to sort of put a human face to this conflict, a conflict in which, you know, 100,000 plus people have been killed since 2007. 25,000 plus people disappeared since 2007. This is a conflict that all of us in this room, all of us in America, are connected to. You know, we are consuming the drugs that are the basis for this war. And so I think, you know, we've become obsessed with ISIS and all these conflicts around the world, but you know, there's this war right on our border that's happening right now. And so I really, again, wanted to put a human face to that war.
Do you consider yourself an activist?
I don't know what I consider myself. Mm-hmm. I think a filmmaker, hopefully. But
what does that mean, Alex? Do you not consider yourself an activist?
I think all of us here consider, well, I don't want to speak for everybody else, but I think being a filmmaker is a pretty good occupation. And I don't think that, and I think that an activist seems to suggest that there's some kind of agenda for which the making of a film is a means to an end. And I think actually the making of a film is part of a journey. And if it's a good film, it delivers a version of the world that that may provoke, it may lead people to action, but hopefully leads us to understand a lot more about the human condition in ways that can only be captured because there's a film, rather than using filmmaking as a kind of vending machine for a predictable result.
That's a very good segue to watching this clip from Matthew's film. There's a scene where your protagonists are being disarmed by the police force, and it's a tough one. So let's take a look at a scene from Cartel Land. It's crazy to ask again, but you were shooting. I mean, that's it just seems a very, very dangerous position to be putting yourself in, needless to say, and you must have been concerned for your safety quite a bit.
Yeah, you know, it was a terrifying film to make at every step, and it got more and more dangerous. I think, you know, this just watching this clip so close, I was thinking about a lot of things while watching it. First of all, I was thinking about how amazing it is what we all do and the sort of diversity of all these different films and how wonderful this art form is to be able to tell stories in so many different ways. I was thinking about a lot of things, but another thing I was thinking about was, you know, that woman who's screaming at the soldiers, both of her parents were killed by the cartel. Both of her brothers were killed by the cartel. Her anger was such that she had actually never been able to tell anyone about this. We were the first people that she ever told. She was so scared that the police either were working with the cartel, being paid by the cartel, or rat her out to the cartel. And so, and that's why movements like this rise up. When institutions fail, you know, we see movements like this rise up all around the world. And so that's one of the things that really motivated me in making this film, is sort of the suffering of people like her that we saw almost every single day. And so, you know, our danger or safety or lack thereof was pales in comparison to what they lived through on a daily basis.
Wow. Well, please don't do it again. Maybe find yourself a nice little comedy or something.
Now it's time to make a comedy again.
Good.
That's funny.
All right, for our final clip, before we get to our final clip, Asif, I just want to ask you one thing, and it applies to others as well, but you are our final clip, so I'm going to talk to you about this question. After I read this, so correct me if I'm wrong, that after the film came out, Amy's father made some claims that he was portrayed in the worst possible light, and then he refused to be associated with the film. That's one of the things that we kind of deal with from time to time as documentary filmmakers. Films come out, and the people in them aren't necessarily, they don't think it's necessarily the most flattering portrayal. But what was the situation with that? And has that hurt the film or your feelings?
Well, have you seen the film? I mean, he's kind of a particular character. And he talks a lot. He's, you know, everyone's had an experience, I suppose, of people maybe who, you know, I'm not a fan of the film. For me, I'm making a movie about Amy, clues in the title. It's about her. She's the one who lived the life. She's the one who experienced things, wrote about them. She sang the song, she wrote the songs. She's the one who's not here anymore. She's the one who died. So the idea that someone else can say, poor me, you know, you're showing, it's like, well, actually, it's not about you, it's about her. And this does come up a lot, and he's got quite a presence in the UK, and he's got quite a few friends in the media, so there's been quite a lot of stuff about the film and about the filmmakers in the media. But for me, it's, you know, pretty consistent. Once we started doing our homework and our research, we spoke to a lot of people, and we knew, my producer and I talked about it quite a lot, and the editor, that, you know, if we get the film out and get it right, that there'll be certain people that won't be happy about it. But we wanted to make the film, and we wanted to make the film for her, and to show what happened to Amy. And in a way, lots of people made a lot of choices and decisions that worked out well for them, and people did quite well. They've become personalities in the media. Maybe people made some money, but she didn't. It didn't turn out very well for her. And I think that was our mission, was just to kind of deal with that, know that it's going to come and it's going to keep happening, and it will come up in every Q&A. But actually, I owed it to her, really. That was the point, really.
Yeah, I hesitated to bring it up, but it is something we all deal with.
Yeah.
And he's making his own movie.
He may be making one about me.
Alex is
he wanted to.
Let's take a look at a clip from Amy. Well, we have gone quite a bit over time, actually, and I apologize for that. It's my bad. I could actually go another hour with each of the filmmakers. We will, as promised, take a couple of questions from the audience. Let's do maybe one question for each film.
Excellent. Thank you. And thank you to all of you.
Thank you.
For sharing the complexities of your marriage, for potentially sharing your Halloween costume, Asif, next year. And our nominees will be hanging around a bit with us in the reception, so if you have other questions, which I'm sure you do, they'll be here. Thank you for coming.